So we dive into our first panel session for the day, and the session will be moderated by Mr. Gaurav Pawa, Vice President Sales, VServe. Let's welcome our panelists. Mr. Gurjot Shah Singh, Senior Vice President and National Media Head, Dentsu Web Chutney. Along with Mr. Nishit Srivastav, CEO, CubeRoot Technologies, along with Ms. Kanika Mittal, Digital Leader. Well, this discussion is going to be about data collection versus data privacy. And it's going to tell us as to where we draw the line, where we draw the boundary. I request that we please put our hands together to welcome all our esteemed panelists, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much for taking out your precious time to be with us here today. And we look forward to listening to you.
So welcome, everyone. I think what we are going to discuss today at this panel discussion is very, very pertinent topic. This is about data collection versus data privacy. And where do we draw the line? I think in the morning session, Mr. Batra just gave us glimpses about the digital transformation that we are actually seeing. And what we see that as a click of a button, we are buying products, we are consuming a lot of content online, we are expressing our views, opinion with our friends, with the world at large. But what is really happening at the back end, there is a big data machinery, okay, which is working, trying to maneuver us to some desired results by apprehending certain information that we have left or we have shared, intentionally or inadvertently with others. So there is a growing, businesses are evolving, and somewhere it is considered very important for businesses because of the, diminishing loyalty that they're seeing from consumers, to constantly innovate. And as a result of that, they really are looking at a lot of data points that they can get about their customers. But at the same time, I think there is a proliferation of such businesses who are constantly looking out and searching for more and more insights about its consumers. So I think with keeping this in mind, looking at this aspect, while there is a value in collecting consumer data, how could all this be made less invasive? So I would like to invite, I think, some comments from Gurjot, because I think he comes with a background understanding the consumer's perspective. And maybe you could open the discussion here, Gurjot.
Thank you. Thank you, Gaurav. I think more than just a consumer's perspective, I think none of us in the industry would have been successful if we wouldn't have cared about our consumer today. And what I really feel, how to make it less invasive, is the only way about that is, I feel, is about telling the customer upfront about where the data is going to be used. Gaurav just mentioned about, at times we end up leaving our data behind knowingly, at times unknowingly. I think all of that is happening because we're leaving that one tick mark that we're collecting your data right at the bottom of the screen or somewhere hidden in the screen. I think that's something that we really need to get rid of. Speaking from the consumer's shoes, I think it's very important as a consumer that we should know where our data is getting collected and where is it going to be used. So I think it's very important that we, in this entire zone of collecting so much of data, it's important that we move towards consent-based marketing, where there is an explicit consent that's been taken from the consumers of where my data will be used. Because if given a choice to me of leaving my data and not leaving my data behind, I need to leave my data behind for me to be convenient about accessing internet today. Sure. So that's important for me. So I think consent-based marketing is important as a consumer for me to proceed further in the way I explore things on web.
Kanika, would you like to add?
Yeah, I'd love to, and I really like the point that you made. Is the mic working, by the way?
Yeah, it is. Okay.
Really like the point that you make about consent marketing. But you know, even before I address that, can I just take a minute to say how nice it is just to be back, like, you know, to a hall that is full of people. It's so heartwarming. And to feel the mic in the hand and to feel the blare of the lights on the face. It's been like more than 2 years. So just, I just want to begin by saying a huge thanks to the organizers. It's just great to be here in a hall full of people and in such a safe place. Moving back to the topic here, you know, that the panel is discussing, I just want to go a step further to what, you know, my esteemed panelists just said and add that it depends also on what are the various sources of data that a marketer is using. One, of course, are the channels that is developed and used and maintained by the marketers themselves, where consent becomes hugely important. But also at the same time, they're also buying data. They're also interacting with different forms of agencies and partnerships to get the kind of data they need to deliver the right ROI for the business. And I think that's where having a very strong sense of responsibility and a strong sense of balance becomes extremely critical. Many of you are marketers in this room, and I'm very, very sure that you feel the pressure to deliver on ROI, right? Like, especially when budgets are constrained, consumer behavior has changed following the pandemic. And in that pressure, there could be a tendency to quickly go after the right kind of data. But I think in that speed, you know, of trying to get the data quickly, it's also important to stand back, reflect, and very responsibly get the right data and check with your different partners that what are the balances that they have in place, what kind of consent are they taking, is the consumer aware, how is the data being used, and then kind of take a step forward and use the data responsibly. So I feel like there has to be a strong balance between consent-based marketing that a marketer engages with on their own, but at the same time that the data that they procure, they have to be extra cautious and hold their partners accountable to extremely high standards.
Right, thank you. That was an interesting perspective. So, you know, when I really look at what are we really leaving behind as footprints on digital media, our financial information is there, our health records are there. If there is, you know, a breach here and there, people panic. Yeah, and we have seen instances in the past that, you know, when the businesses, they are, collecting data, they may not be the technology guys, okay? They are consumer businesses. However, they're collecting data. They need to really rely on certain partners, technology partners, platforms, to put it in a perspective, okay, to, you know, enable them to analyze the data properly. And as I said, you know, there could be certain innocent mistakes also that may happen, okay, and the data breaches happen and the panic is there. What needs to be done there when you're talking about, you know, mitigating that suspicion or building trust as it is very important, right? How marketers do that, how, you know, you, Nishit, you're a part of a company that manages data of millions of people and help marketers also, you know, kind of have deeper insights about their audiences, data lake offerings. Where do you see, how do you see this mitigation happening?
Thank you, Gaurav. Good afternoon, everybody. As far as the question is concerned, I see regulators and policy makers have a very great role to play. And what we have seen in this last 5 to 6 years, the laws and the policies in India has still not been populated the way it has been done in the Western countries. So one of the very popular compliance which has been followed worldwide is GDPR compliance in European Union, and that is the zenith of the compliance and the policies, what our data stored, how the data needs to be stored, how it needs to be secured, how it needs to be processed. And there it has been clearly stated that the control should be primarily given to the consumer. Okay. So most of the times when we are talking to our clients or, you know, agencies or, you know, marketeers for that matter, we see that that marketeers claim that, you know, they are the owners of the, you know, data. For the consumers, because if you have bought certain product on, you know, let's say an e-commerce website, the marketers or the brand assume that that they have acquired the consumer data also. But as per the policies, regulators, it should be explicitly mentioned, and the control should be given back to the consumer that how that data will be primarily used by that brand or by that e-commerce portal. So there, a lot of things needs to be done here. I see there's a lot of scope here, and good thing is that we are already working with the policymakers, the forums there, and they are thinking on it, and we see that in all the 2 years. Those policies will also be formulated.
Sure. Anything you would want to contribute?
I just want to add that one is the policy aspect of it, which is very critical, right? Like the way you said around the creation of the policies and the right implementation of the policy. But also from the point of the consumer, at what point does he sort of reach to certain terms and conditions also matters. Typically, terms and conditions related to consent of sharing data are slided in right at the end of a contract, or when you're buying something or subscribing to something. All of these things come right at the end. And by the time you're pretty much, already at the end of your decision-making stage, so you pretty much give what is called inferred consent, or you just give the consent without thinking, you do it because you're really not left with a choice sometimes. You want to choose convenience, and you know that your convenience is coming at a price, but you just are left a bit cornered, and so you go ahead and you give the consent without really wanting to give it. I think the onus of various industry bodies and on all of us also lies in making this particular aspect a little bit more easier for the consumer, where the choice to give the data or not give the data is actually asked to the consumer at the right time. And not sitting at a point where it doesn't really have an effective time to make the choice, or is simply forced to do it in some way. So I think the experience, if I may say, goes hand in hand with policy on really having consumers let us use their data the right way. Does that make sense?
Sure, absolutely. And just to add further to that and possibly take your opinion about it, what would you think, what if there's a regulation, and I think somewhere regulator also needs to play a part. The consumer needs to be given enough power, a power to see that what brands are using, what kind of data about them that the brands are using. So different brands or different categories have, different privacy policies. So what you actually, allow a bank to see or your stockbroker to see, you may not want a retailer to see. Okay, so I think that if a regulator also could play a part, and there's a mechanism which is set up where consumers at large can go across to any merchant or online platform and figure out that what is the kind of a data that those merchants or those platforms have about them, and they have all the right to revoke the permissions or allow it. So what do you think, Nishit, in terms of the regulator aspect, where does it come from, what kind of a role that a regulator could play? You talked about, international laws, how evolved we are here right now and what needs to be done?
It's not like that we don't have existing laws on the desk. We have ID Act and there are certain 1859 laws which has already been formulated. So I'm not an expert on the law, legal aspects, and a disclaimer also, that don't take whatever I say, that it is carbon stone. Now, thing is, as far as the laws and the formulation is concerned, I think the need of the hour is the self-regulation. Okay, so we need to move forward ethically and in an ethical manner where we give the control back to the user. There's a kind of information, I'm sure that most of the people sitting in the audience, they don't have any problem with non-personal identifiable information, that we call it non-PI information, is stored and secured. But the moment it comes to the personally identifiable information, which is called PI information, coming in place, and we most of the brand or technology company like us, we start storing your personally identifiable information, then the issue starts coming in. So as far as the privacy policy and the usage policy of the website, they should explicitly mention that, you know, how, what kind of personal identifiable information that brand or that website or that publisher is using and how it is processing that data. So as long as, you know, as Manjot also mentioned initially, as long as consumer is informed and he is dealt in a transparent manner, I think that most of the people, they don't have an issue. There was a study done by Accenture in 2016, and they said that 70% of the people, they were not having an issue as long as they were informed transparently about how their data is being processed. Even it is used that person, that PI information.
I love the idea, Gaurav, that you proposed. In fact, I think some entrepreneurship picked up and built on it. Like, really, it's fantastic. I think what Gaurav, if I may just elaborate, I think what you were saying is almost like an aggregator website or an aggregator app. Like, you have Tread, for example, where all your credit cards are aggregated and you know exactly, you know, what fees is correct and what is not. Similarly, there's an aggregation somewhere that can be done through a technology company, where once you go in, you log into your profile and you see what kind of data is being shared across what kinds of applications, whether it's social media or e-commerce or banking or otherwise. And you actually have an off and on button there that allows you to choose at different stages in your life what you want to protect and what you want to give. I think that would be brilliant and it's absolutely disruptive. And hopefully someone in the audience will get inspired and maybe pick that up for
quite
education.
We have permissions that in our phones. You know, what kind of permissions you grant to what all apps. So something similar from a platform perspective. Gurjo, I just wanted to bring this up for you. There's a causal relationship between our actions, our data, and their far-reaching effects. Okay, and that's still obscure at this point of time. Should consumers be actually, again, taking a different view about what we are discussing here? But should consumers be really told how the data is being used? Would they not get the chills once they actually get to know what all information about them is available in the world wide web or with certain companies?
Yeah, so I think I'll first connect the dot backwards in what we've been talking about, giving the control back to the consumer or giving the authority back to the consumer. I don't think there's any giving back. It always stays with the consumer. Whatever data we leave behind as consumers, it's the data of the consumer. Well, I've been a marketer myself for 12 years, but I don't think so any of us would have succeeded if we would have not cared about our consumers, like I mentioned earlier. But the control very much stays with the consumer. And I feel that as a consumer, if not tomorrow, see, digital today is not the fourth or the fifth or the sixth preferred medium. As we move along, we've seen humanity has seen a mega shift. And we know digital is not just about marketing anymore. It's how our life is being into existence, right? So digital is the most preferred medium. Sooner or later, we all have to accept the transparency. Look at why GDPR laws got created. Europeans, they were very well aware about their laws, which is where they pointed out, hey, why is my data or why aren't the permissions being taken explicitly? Which is why all over the world it is now being formed as a GDPR policy. So the faster marketers and brands accept this, that you're going to be telling upfront where my data is going to be used, the better it would be, because otherwise it can cause more disruption in the system and I think users and consumers will only get insecure about it. Honestly, it's a balance that we're going to hit naturally. It's better if we approach it more cautiously and get there faster. So yeah, as a consumer, my data is always mine. The control is never. I think a marketer has enough other powers to live with. So marketers don't need more powers. Let the powers rest where they need to be. And that's how I think we should proceed to a more safer space on internet.
Yes, the data, marketers need to make data as their friend, and they should know how to manage their friends.
Or just to add to that, what Pujo mentioned. There's a concept called data portability. In the advanced market, when a consumer is told that all their data is being utilized, all is being processed, so the user and consumer is interested in taking the data back from that technology company or from that portal and put it in a different company. So those kind of laws needs to be there where we need, you know, obviously we need to inform the consumer about how the data is being processed and used. But at the same time, if we empower them, you know, by giving them this kind of, you know, portability where they can put, you know, get that derived data or whatever information which is being processed back to the user, I think that will create a win-win situation for the entire, you know, community.
That's very interesting perspective. Generally also, you know, I would be looking forward to kind of figuring out that, you know, you also have your work and you have a DMP in place. Typically, what are the checks, internal checks from a staff perspective, you guys have in place to ensure that, you know, the privacy is maintained, the data handling, certain policies that you have in your company which gives confidence to consumers, which gives confidence to marketers that they're dealing with the right partner. What are those checks? Do you want to highlight some of those?
Yeah, definitely. So, you know, as far as checks and balances, internal balances are concerned, we are forced by the, you know, the buyer client, by a publisher partner, that, you know, if that data breach is there, you know, we will pay a penalty. So it's a sensitive subject, and the same, you know, if the penalty is huge, you know, we need to sign back an agreement with our data scientists, with our technology guys back in the company to ensure that, you know, that the data is, you know, secured and they're encrypted in the right manner so that they are not encrypted back and, you know, it's not misused. Not coming back, you know, from the marketeers and from a partner's perspective, our partners make sure that while they are taking consent from their consumer, they mention it explicitly that they are sharing that data with a technology company like us, the third-party companies. So that explicit thing is mentioned there, and is part of the GDPR guidelines that we follow. And you know, then if the consumer opts to process with a third-party technology company like us, they get the data to us, and then we inform them that how we are processing them, what are the derived data points that we are getting to that, and how those data points can be given back to the consumer.
Right.
The opt-out features are there at every stage, which you know, every consumer would love to have.
Sure. Coming back to you, Kanika, just taking your perspective of being an aggressive marketer, to what limits can a marketer really go?
Oh my God, that's a tough one, you know. I think just for a little bit of context, before I answer Gaurav's question, I think times have really changed for marketers. Like, there was a time when there was a lot of focus on brand marketing, which essentially meant, you know, the halo style of marketing where you would use perhaps less of digital, more of television, outdoor, print, etc. And really create like a complete, you know, beautiful image of your brand. Then it pivoted to a lot of performance marketing, you know, when a plethora of ad networks and a plethora of technology companies came into the country and offered marketers the entire click-through journey where they would get the results that they were looking for, and most importantly, they would get the attribution that they were looking for. And that temptation, I think, for any marketer was huge. And that was also a time when the industry was really evolving and there were not so many discussions and conversations around data and how to use the data. And there was this whole rush to go in for the bottom funnel, or, you know, hit your bottom line using the bottom of the funnel and all of these new tools that were available. And I think that was a time when perhaps many marketers in their aggression would have used these tools very differently, not knowing that tomorrow there is a different aspect unfolding in the future. But now, once, you know, we've all gone through this sea change with the pandemic, and the increased awareness that has happened with regulation and, you know, government talks and several other things, there is definitely increased awareness and sensibility and responsibility with marketers today. And two things are emerging as a result of that. One, there is a better balance coming within the realm of brand performance marketing. Because frankly speaking, data is required more for performance than brand marketing. And today, there's a sense of balance. Companies want to do very meaningful, very purposeful communication. They want to tell the right stories. They want to have an effective presence on social media where they're able to build their personality, have a tone, and connect with their consumers. And that they can do independent of deep data. And then there's another side to it, which is the performance marketing, in which they are now balancing the brand marketing and saying, what do we need, when do we need, where do we need, and what's the best way to get it. And so it's a lot more sensitized, it's a lot more careful, and I think, and that sense of balance and responsibility is really making this whole thing take very well. So I think one big trend that's kind of helping this conversation that Gaurav just raised is there's a better balance between brand and performance. And the second is that, you know, just in terms of the sheer industry level awareness, all of us in this room today having this conversation is a clear testament to the fact that anyone listening to us or going back simply in their subconscious mind will be more assessive and more careful in whatever steps they take in the future. So the sheer plethora of conversation in the market, in the industry with peers is building a collective sense of responsibility. And I think even though marketers tend to get very aggressive, this sense of responsibility is now here to stay and to remain.
Right, thank you. I think, good job, one perspective that I really wanted to have from you, you have consulted probably more than 200 brands in your career, you know, and you've been a part of a lot of award-winning campaigns as well. How tempted are you to, again, you know, from a marketing perspective there, you know, from an advertising perspective, or an agency perspective, how tempted are you to leverage an understanding of campaign of one brand for another brand? Okay, because there is a data there, okay, which talks about this is a market that performed well for this particular brand. And we're talking about vernacular, could be vernacular. You know, you could figure out that, you know, down south in Kerala, this brand performs well. Okay, so that's a data, that's a takeaway data point for an agency. Typically, that belongs to a marketer, you know, from that perspective. But you are, I think, you know, we tend to, all of us, we tend to use those business intelligence for benefit of other brands also. How far would you take that, or, you know, what is the kind of agreements that you have with your brands to protect that sort of, you know, kind of a data or a privacy from that sense?
Okay, so Gaurav, successfully you pushed me back to a marketer's shoe from a consumer's shoe. They call you always wear two hats. I wear two turbans of a customer and a marketer. So now talking from a marketer's lens, firstly, more than just brands at Dentsu, we're bloody serious about data privacy and regulations. So much so, I think we are one of the few agencies and group who have a data protection officer in India, not just outside India as well. There are very few, and I think there would be two at an overall level in India. We've been having a data protection officer for almost over 2 years now. So coming back to the point that you mentioned, as a marketer, I think as marketers, when we take out inferences and learnings from some data that exists for one brand or for one market, etc., the inferred learning that we extract from any data and that learning is applied anywhere else, I feel that's not a breach of data because that's a learning interpreted by a marketer individually. However, on the other hand, no data can ever be cross-pollinated within Dentsu. We're sworn to that. And I think that should be any marketer's rule of operation, that there should be no data migration, but of course there has to be learnings that migrate from one brand, one category to the other. That's what a marketer does in the course of executing successful marketing campaigns.
Yeah, I think so. We are pretty much covered a whole lot of issues around the subject, and I made some notes. And if I were to, you know, kind of sum it up, I really feel that data privacy is tied to customer experience. I think in addition to providing best products and services, businesses must also provide consumers a sense of security, okay, as it pertains to their personal life. Enterprise needs to really state upfront to consumers, and that's what consumers would appreciate, that what kind of data about them that the companies are using, what value that it could add to a consumer, to their business or to third party. I think that upfront stating that should work well to build that trust And then we also talked about putting the power in hands of customers. Yeah, importance of consent needs to be realized by the companies. Consent management systems needed to be put in place, and consumers to be made aware that every business has a privacy policy, right? So finally, enterprises are also ambitious, right? And they want to push boundaries. They really want to push. If you keep playing safe all the time, you may not be able to innovate. Okay, in order to innovate, you will have to push boundaries. However, they have to really carefully play a maker checker there themselves. And the regulator also need to come and play their part, make consumers aware of their rights, of the privacy policies. And once the regulator somehow comes and takes a point, takes a position, I think marketers would also follow, right, to build that trust. So I think, just overall to sum it, if you really say that between, you know, kind of figure out that between data collection and data privacy, where to draw a line, we may not have a black and white, you know, answer to that. We can't put it in black and white. But definitely, as we tried putting it all together, there are regulators, there are corporates, there are consumers who together can, you know, come together to evolve this entire ecosystem and make this a win-win situation for everyone. I think with that, we would we'd like to end and open the floor for any queries that you may have. We would be happy to address it. Please introduce yourself and let us know for whom the query is meant for.
Check.
Hi, all right.
I'm Karan. I run digital for Dalmia Cement. So news broke yesterday that Facebook is going to take away race and religion as data points in the US. As marketeers who primarily work in the Indian markets and knowing the data sets we have available, what data sets do you think should ideally be taken away so that it makes the consumers life on digital safer while leaving all the commercial value that we as marketeers have in place? So any thoughts on that based on the data sets that we do have available now?
Do you want to take this? Yeah.
It was a very interesting question. I'll probably answer it in the reverse. I think the data sets that are needed are perhaps, you know, more demographic and sociographic and transactional in nature, because they help to build the customer's profile, you know, like his likes, his interests, so that the brand can serve him in the best way. So what I would say is that look at it the other way. What are the data points really needed to build the right kind of customer profile that it makes a marketer, or rather gives the marketer, better insight into how to serve him? And whatever data sets don't feed into that profile or are just additional information, just remove those. So I think that's the best way I can answer this.
Adding a little more to that, I think Facebook and Google are very popular platforms, but like how Gaurav started right in the beginning about digital transformation, you don't know how many other technology players or media partners are capturing all that information. Today I also leave information about my salary in my messages, and I allow Google to read my messages, and there you go. All the micro-investment apps are reading my salaries. They're reading where am I investing. They're reading, Facebook is reading, I'm eating Maggie because I'm posting about having Maggie with my nephew. I'm posting about move to a new city. I'm posting about all my habits. I think what's important is, in some way, knowingly or unknowingly, there are many data sets that are being created, but it's very important that when I'm leaving any of this information behind, I should be told explicitly, as a consumer, it's my right to know explicitly that where all this data is going to be used. Is eating Maggie with my nephew gonna be used later to retarget me or not? Probably that's something, like I said, we're gonna naturally find a balance between the black and white. Gaurav, I think the black and white doesn't exist now, but hopefully maybe next 6 months, 1 year, when we hit the stage again, there will be a black and white. So we should just be explicitly told, and there are many data sets that exists.
Thank you. Sure. And again, the power to the consumer. At the end of the day, if he knows what about him is known to anybody, any third party, he should have, you know, that transparency with him and the power to revoke those permissions, if at all.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gaurav, and thank you very much,
Thank you very much, Mr. Gurjot.
Thank you, Mr. Nishit. And yes, Ms. Kanika Mittal, thank you very much. That was very, very good. And thank you for taking us through some fantastic highlights that we all got to know about. And on that note, I'd like to request Mr. Sanjay Sindhwani, CEO, Indian Express Online, to please come up on stage and give a token of appreciation to our esteemed panelists. And can we please put our hands together? Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.